A lot of this maintenance stuff should have or could have been addressed up front. But from my perspective, let's look at it here. So now, what I want to do here, and just to kind of end the course with it, is I'm going to start putting dollars on things, and I haven't done that yet. I'm going to start putting costs, life cycle costs on things. I'm also going to look at how do I repair it in the field, what are the costs of doing so, what's the life cycle cost, et cetera. So I'm going to look at it all from a maintenance perspective. Now, before I get there, I kind of mentioned that up front. I could, at this point, if that list that I put at the beginning of component, failure modes, causes, effects, if I've got that, I can automatically generate diagnostics, right? I could generate a whole list that I take every effect, I say no light. Well, then I can go through which one is the most likely and then phrase it into English questions. Is the bulb good? Is the bulb making contact with the base? So now I've got a whole repair guide or diagnostics kind of coming in from my original work without really needing to go ahead and do any more engineering work or get engineers involved. I've got the best information already. All I need is after I create the skeleton, so I said, go get the English major to go in and just convert those into sentences that make sense. Again, that's a heck of a lot cheaper than getting a bunch of engineers and better. Again, so what ends up by following the entire process, what you now have is the best knowledge you could have. It's a complete source of knowledge that comes in there and makes up your diagnostics versus putting in 7 people or 8 people after the fact in a room and say, make up the diagnostics. Okay, because you're gonna miss something. Okay, here, I not only do it faster, I'm eliminating the work that needs to be done there. At the end, I'm getting a better result. And this again goes back to the biggest thing that if you look at the process, you are doing things and you're doing them faster, you're also doing them better. And at the end of the day, you're also doing them cheaper. If we start getting to maintenance planning and analysis, now I can look at a lot of the things that are already out there. I could look at RCM type of analysis. There's something else called MSG3. There's an RBI. Most of that is for the aircraft industry. RBI is more focused on the oil and gas at the moment. At the end of the day, I'm only going to stay with the top, the RCM type of analysis. But really what's important to kind of realize once you start getting into those is that all of them really require that you first go through and take each one of the components, understand what the failure modes are, put in the causes in there, put in the consequences and effects, and then go put action items on. Okay, so if I do an RCM, that's what I'm doing. If I do an MSG analysis, that's what I'm doing. If I do an RBI analysis, that's kind of what I'm doing with it. Okay, so if I have this here, guess what? How much more work do I have to do? It's a lot less. If I don't have this here, I gotta go recreate all of that. Now, the differences I get into that is really comes into the categorization idea. And the categorization idea goes back into filtering. How do I filter what's important? Obviously, if you're dealing with the aircraft industry, there's other things that the way they filter it, oil and gas filters it another way, traditional RCM filters it another way. End of the day, both of those can be looked at as I've got my failure modes and causes. I try to mitigate causes. That's my objective. How I choose to mitigate causes, it depends where I'm at. I can either mitigate them through design changes, or I can mitigate them through maintenance actions. If I have no control over that, that's all I got. In FMEA, we use change point analysis or risk discovery at the beginning to kind of figure out what I used anyways, to kind of figure out which ones are important. So it turns out that idea comes from RCM. Because most of what you do in RCM is you end up looking at all the components and you go through what they call categorization. The whole idea of categorization is to kind of figure out which one of those components are important enough for me to go further and do analysis on. In this case, now, different standards give you different sets of questions and they're structured a little bit differently. Not necessarily a whole list of yes or no. A lot of them become more of a tree that you tend to go down. And again, this would be different by industry or by standard that you follow. But one generic way to look at it is you go through a set of questions, and what you're trying to really discover is what you end up now doing is what they call categorization. And you categorize something to either, is that an evident safety concern? Is that an evident operational concern? Is that an evident economic concern? Is that a hidden safety? So you end up taking a tree to take you down to all that list. Obviously, anything that comes up as safety, guess what? You're doing something. Okay, as you get into economics, you might use different ways to categorize that. So again, not much different than the way we've looked at it earlier. It's just a different way to, again, figure out which ones of those items you want to end up going through the whole process of adding maintenance tasks to. In RCM terminology, you pretty much call them maintenance significant items, or MSIs. Okay, so you're going through to identify what will be a maintenance significant item. And in this case, I'll go through and say, okay, I've got an evident safety, I got to do something. Then my action is really a task. Terminology changes, whereas in the FMEA I have an action, and in RCM I have a task. That task is an inspection task. So if corrosion, basically, that failure mode was corrosion, frame would fall apart, was effect, it was a safety issue. So then what I want to do, basically, is go and inspect for corrosion and also inspect for fatigue. And let's say do that every 5,000 hours. That is what I'm basically putting in there. That's how I'm mitigating that cause by adding inspections. You could add PMs, you could add replacements, and so forth. And once I set them up, I can decide how often. And then once I put all of that together, I can start doing analysis and see how effective that was. Okay, is that an effective policy for each one of those? And I'll go through and put some numbers on that and make that more effective. So let's go ahead and look at this and try to do some more analysis on the chandelier and look at it from a fan perspective. Let's go ahead and change everything. Let's say I'm not the guy that makes a chandelier anymore. I'm the homeowner that bought it. So as a homeowner that bought it, I'm going to do the maintenance on it. Okay, so now I want to go ahead and do some life cycle cost analysis and look at my maintenance options for the chandelier as a homeowner that buys the chandelier. Now, to do that as a homeowner, one of the things I could be doing is, first of all, I need to understand what the model is from a reliability perspective to kind of do the analysis. So from a maintenance side, what I'm going to end up doing is keep things at a higher level. I'm going to basically encapsulate all the objects at a much higher level because I really don't care what's below them. Okay, why do I do that? Well, I don't really need to know what goes all the way below. I want to bring it back to my LRU level, line replaceable units. So basically, if the chandelier fails, what's going to fail? Is it the frame, the wiring, the bulb, or the socket, right? So if the bulb fails, and I'm looking at it from a maintenance perspective, do I really care why it failed? I got to replace it at the end of the day, right? So what I'm looking at is, what is the probability of it failing? And then I'll take whatever actions that I do if it fails. So I'm choosing to do that. You don't have to. You could do that with the software pretty easily. And so in effect, what I did is, I took all that information below that, and I actually created a higher level model. And again, that's just ways to keep things simpler from my perspective. One of the things you notice as you go through that reliability system hierarchy that we created, you'll find out that there's two options at each item. You could define, at least especially when you're looking at reliability or how it fails, you could define things at any level, or you could choose to inherit from below. Obviously, at the lowest level, you have to define it at that level. Anything above it in the hierarchy, you could inherit everything from below. Now, within synthesis, we allow you to actually define models at the function level as well as the failure level. In this case, the function level doesn't make any sense why we would let you define something there, because everything should be inherited from below. Now, why do we let you do that? Well, here's the problem. If I wanted to put in interactions on things below that, I could put them there because there's no other place to put in the system hierarchy. If I wanted to take everything below that and actually represent them by a much more complex RBD, rather than assume everything's in series, what I would do is I would build that based on the causes, create an object, and then define that object at a higher level, which kind of brings everything in there. It's an analytical capability rather than a physical way of doing things. I'm the homeowner, I bought the chandelier, I got some choices to make. Okay, so now I'm gonna look at my maintenance strategy on the whole thing. So I'll go through the systems that are in there, frame, wiring, bulb, and socket. Frame fails, will I fix it? No, I'll go buy a new chandelier, right? Wiring fails, will I fix it? Probably not, I'm gonna buy a new chandelier. Bulb fails, will I fix it? Okay, so that I'll repair. Socket fails, let's say I'll repair it at the socket level too. Okay, that's my strategy. So now I've got my maintenance strategy. So let's start out with that. Then I can start creating more objects to add costs and to add other things that would make sense in my analysis. So let's start out with a whole chandelier, and let's make that a part because I need to replace it. So let's go give it some properties. Let's give it a cost. So for me to replace the chandelier, cost $250. Give it a standard deviation of 20 just for fun, because it's not a contract. You know, it could be different prices depending on when I buy it. Let's make that a probabilistic value. Okay. Then let's also say, well, it takes about 7 days to get it, standard deviation of 2. So I've got a time to get it. Also, it takes about 4 hours, standard deviation of 1 to replace it. So I'm adding a lot of other variables in there. The reason I'm doing all of those is I want to get to availability and cost. So I want to put times in there and dollars. So that becomes my chandelier part object. Then I may start creating crews. Who's going to do that? Obviously, to replace the chandelier, I'm not going to do it myself. So I'm going to have to go out there and hire an electrician. And my choice is the Eclectic Electric. So those guys are going to come in and replace the chandelier. Let's also say they like to charge me $50 per call. That's a call fee. And then they'll charge me $150 an hour after that, how long it takes them to do it. Also, they don't show up the minute I call them because they got other better customers than me. So it takes about 10 days to get me on the schedule in the average, say, standard deviation of 2. Then I can get into a maintenance strategy, okay? So now, for the bulb, if the bulb fails, I'm gonna go ahead and replace it. I'm the homeowner. Now, I can look at how long it takes me to do that job, and let's say that it takes me about 5 minutes to replace the bulb, and maybe make that 5 minutes standard deviation of 1, and it takes me about 10 minutes to actually get dressed up so I look like a real, you know, I put on my tool belt and all that good stuff, because I can't just be replacing the bulb without all the tools there, right? Just in case. So I've got some times in there. Let's also say that my wife doesn't want to pay me, so my services are free, so I'm not going to put any cost on that. So I've got a time to do that. Now, I could also, as a homeowner, create my sparing strategy. And if you notice, I got Home Depot there in the back, because you can't do anything at home without having to go there a couple of times, or Lowe's, or whatever that is. So my strategy as a homeowner, you know, I've been influenced about all these great companies out there that everything they do is just in time. So I'm going to do just-in-time stocking on my bulbs. So what's going to happen is I'm not going to keep a bulb around. And when it burns, I'm going to run over to Home Depot and get me a new bulb and put it in there. Okay, so that's my policy. Right or wrong, we'll look at it. Now, if I'm going to do that, I got to drive down time to the store. I got to get to the store, park the car, buy the bulb, drive back home. Got about 2 hours, standard deviation of 30 minutes to do the whole thing. Then I got cost. I got the bulb. Cost about $5, and then I got expenses for the car to get there and back, so I've got those variables in there. So again, I'm going to have the electrician do it. I've got different parameters of how much it's going to cost me for the electrician. Now, this is pretty much standard, and we tend to do quite a bit of that in maintainability analysis. One of the things we don't consider, and I want to consider right now, is something that's actually a lot more important than all of those costs. What that is loss of revenue. If you're an airline and you got a plane, you know, the cost of the parts is important, but that's sitting over at Denver Airport for 3 weeks, got an aircraft on ground, where you need somewhere else to be carrying passengers, there's a huge cost with that too. So it's the additional cost that you get from loss of revenue, loss of production, and so forth. So let's put some of that in there. Let's say that I'm gonna make money out of my chandelier. The way I'm gonna do it is I'm gonna put it in a room that I'm gonna rent to somebody. Okay. Now, however, ended up renting this to an injury attorney, and I ended up not getting the best deal on my full rental because I kind of signed a contract that says, okay, I'm going to give you $720 a month for the room, so that's my income. However, here's what's going to happen now. If anything fails in the room, and chandelier is one of the items that could fail, basically you're going to pay me a penalty. So I want a per incident penalty, so I'm going to basically end up paying the attorney an inconvenience fee of $50 per incident. And then at the same time, while the thing's not ready, and I can't stay in the room because nothing's not working, you're gonna put me up in the neighborhood hotel. It's $240 a day. We'll prorate it at $10 an hour. So basically, I'm losing revenue, plus I'm paying a fine on top of that. Which is pretty much what you do when you sign a contract, a maintenance contract for somebody. Okay, you sell somebody an aircraft or you sell somebody an engine, an aircraft engine, and you sign a maintenance contract with them, there are penalties with it, and they're kind of like those. Now, with all of that put together, I could go through that and do the analysis pretty quickly. So once I do that analysis, I may find out, and there's lots and lots of results, especially new version of blocks, and you can get actually thousands of results. But one of the things I may want to look at is mean availability. I got 99% availability. Is that good enough? Who cares? What do I care about in this case? How much is that going to cost me? So I'm going to look at dollars, right? So if I go down to dollars in this particular case, I'll find out very quickly that over the period that I'm considering, which is about a year, I believe, I'm looking at about $2,000 of costs on a $250 chandelier. Okay. So now that whole exercise is going to end up costing me about $2,000. Okay, now I can break that further. Where are those costs coming from? That's why I said you got lots and lots of results. So I can go into the results in a lot more detail. Pretty quick, I've got the system. I can run it in there. Once you're in BlockSim, I mean, I've got pretty much, I can look at tables or results, all spreadsheets. I could add functions in there, make it more complicated, add present value of money or whatever you want me to do in there. Create custom reports as I go through it. But again, I can drill down. What I'm doing is try to drill down and figure out where the costs are. And again, I'm looking at the bulb as being my biggest driver. Okay. And I could look at, obviously, availability is pretty high on all of them. So if that's a metric I'm using, it really wouldn't point to anything at this point. Different views. I could look at cost by block, what's causing it, drill down to each one of those. So again, I get a plethora of results. So kind of different ways to visualize it. As you move forward, you could actually take this analysis and publish them to your internet portal, and managers can actually view whatever dashboards you put together if you wanted to show your results. So that's kind of neat after effect at an enterprise level. So once I've done all of that, I'll get in through this and start going down through the details. And as I go through that, I'll find out that overall, even though the bulb cost me about $1,600, and that's drilling down to the bulb itself, really the cost for bulbs was about $117. Labor to change the bulbs was zero, because again, I'm the one changing it, right? System level failure costs, basically what I'm looking at is the $50 per pop. Okay, what are the fines I'm paying? So I paid about $500 on that. Then I can go down and look at downtime cost. Remember, I'm paying the attorney $10 an hour every time that's down. Well, I've got about $1,000 on that. And then I'm also losing about $123 worth of rent during that particular time. So really, what's driving that number is pretty much a lot of the stuff over there. Now, obviously, it's pretty trivial in this case. My very, very smart decision to use just-in-time sparing and not keeping light bulb around is pretty much really what's driving that number right there. Right? So if I had an extra bulb, that downtime shouldn't be there. Or at least it should be a lot less. It should be as long as it takes me to change a bulb. I don't have to drive to Home Depot every time, and I've got all that downtime. So what I could start doing is go through that and change that. I could go in, okay, I'm going to change my sparing policy. And again, you can do all of that virtually as to what it makes sense. So I go, okay, here's my new one. I'll keep one bulb around. When that bulb fails and I use it, I'll go get another one. That's my sparing policy in this particular case. Now, the minute I've done that, I've just dropped that by about $900, right? So I'm down to about $1,000 now, or $1,100. On my cost for 10,000 hours. So again, relooking at some of those decisions can have a huge impact on the costs. In this case, that was my sparing decision is what ended up being the most significant impact on that. I could start looking at things in more detail. I could look at now policies. Do I inspect? Do I PM it? You know, why can't I PM the bulb? Why don't I just replace the bulb before it fails? Is that an option? Well, let's look at that. If I understand how something fails, okay, I understand what its failure probability is or what its failure rate behavior is, and then I know what the cost is of, let's say, of a failure. In this case, $1,500 for 10 failures, it's about $150 per failure is what it's costing me, right? Versus what does it cost me if I buy one ahead of time and I just PM it? So it costs me $5 every time I choose to PM it. So if it's costing me $5 to PM it and $150 if I don't PM it in a later round of failure, then I can go through an optimization and tell you, you know what? That's your optimum PM time. If you want to go ahead and do that, replace that bulb every 260 hours. And based on that, that's your minimum cost point. Obviously, doing it too much at the beginning doesn't make any sense because you're going to waste too much time on bulbs. Waiting too long, you're taking too much risk. So based on what that cost ratio is, you could very easily compute a single point where you set up your PM policy to. I could take that even further and I would say, well, maybe I want to do on condition or inspection based type of a maintenance policy. Let's say that for the bulb itself, wife went out and got me these lumen measuring guns that I can point it to the bulb and I can figure out how many lumens it's got at any time. And now if I do that, there's a certain probability. If I do it at the right time, I may catch an imminent failure. If I do it at the wrong time, I'm wasting my time, right? So I could inspect at optimum intervals. So I could go back and say, hey, there's a distribution that describes how I fail, but at the same time, this random variable could also be detected through another distribution, right? So there is a probability of detection that comes in here. So if I understand what those are and I know what the costs are, because obviously you need to have costs, because if it's free to inspect, then the optimum solution will be do it every second. Let's say I'll put a 50-cent cost on me going in there and checking the lumens. Then I could go through that and say, well, I could compute an optimum inspection time. Let's say if I go in there now based on whatever I know, every 18 hours, go in there and measure the lumens, that's basically your cost optimum inspection interval to make sure that you catch an upcoming failure on the bulb. So I got two options. I can go in there every 260 hours and change a bulb out, or I can go in every 18 hours and kind of measure it, and if it measures below a certain threshold value, then I replace it. Now, obviously, an aside, math likes to give you exact numbers like this that may or may not make sense. If I have to do this every 18 hours, that might mean I have to wake up the lawyer at 3 in the morning, and I don't know how much that's going to cost me. So that may not be, even though mathematically it may be an optimum solution, it may not be optimum from other perspectives. So I could change that. Let's say even though 18 is optimum, I could make a choice and say it's 24. I'll do it every morning at 9 o'clock when he's at work. So now once I have all of that, what I can go ahead and do fairly easily now is I can go rerun all of the analysis I did with all the options, right? And perhaps by doing so, I may tell you that's what I got now from costs. Scenario one, run to failure, no spare. That's my overall cost over that time frame. Run to failure with a spare, that was the second one. Then I go through, run it with a PM of 160 hours, I'm right there. Then run it with an inspection every 18 hours, I'm about the same. I may decide to do an overkill. Hey, I'm gonna do a PM and an inspection. Well, it's gonna cost you more, and you get nothing out of it. But what metrics am I looking at? I'm looking at dollars, right? What I optimize there makes a heck of a lot more sense than me looking at any other metric, because at the end of the day, that's what matters to me. So that's another thing we need to kind of shift quite a bit out of is, let's not get stuck on a number, because that number, there's about a million ways I can mess with that number. Whereas that number, I don't know of a million ways to mess with it. It is what it is. Now, having said that, it gets a lot more complicated than this. I mean, the reality of it is I've done one, I've done a spare pulp, kind of everything's obvious. I kind of played to the answer. You kind of knew what was coming up as I did that. And again, it's easier to teach that way. Reality of it is if you try to do anything complex, you're gonna have thousands of variables. And this is where complexity starts coming in. Okay, and this is again where you go to university professors and you read up papers, they all like to take the single example and there are ways to optimize items at a single level. Truth be told, is in the real world, it's not a single item. It's hundreds of items, it's hundreds of tasks, or thousands, okay? But we can start looking at ways to do that. And we do have the ability to kind of look at what we did before. So if I take a much more complex system, and let's go back to turbofan engine. I mean, that's a fairly complicated item, okay? So one of the things, if I start looking at even the reliability of that, even though I have that, there's a lot of variables, okay? There's parts, availability, there is crews, different components have different items. So I've got a lot of different crews, staffing, timing, component reliability, all of those are factors. And those factors start getting fairly large. Trying to optimize the whole thing becomes daunting, and even though with computers today, it becomes so big that most computers won't deal with it to begin with. Okay, you're gonna start crashing out if you try to optimize something with a million variables and you got so many ways to do that. So One of the things we could be doing at this point is, again, remember what I did back when I went to DOEs and I used simulation for the risk analysis? Well, why can't I do that for maintenance? Okay, I can go do the same thing. I can now pick what's my response that's of interest. So, okay, it could be money in this case. I could look at cost, I could look at downtime, availability, throughput. Didn't talk about that. I could be making something or pumping oil. So all of those could be my responses. I could go back now and set up a lot of factors of what are all those variables that I could optimize on. Okay, then I can go back and rerun all of this analysis by varying all of those. And again, if I have thousands of them and it's a complicated system, you know, turn the computer on, come back 3 days later. I mean, I'll fill all of that for you, I'll run all the experiments for you on each one of those, and then I can start looking at what's significant. Which one of those are significant? Start identifying what's significant from a maintenance perspective, then start going after those. And then start modifying what those are. So again, I have the ability to do all of that because now it becomes more of how do I use the information. The information's already there, I can slice and dice it in different ways. So I can start looking up to maintenance in a much better light. Even though I came up with optimums for each one of them, other things you're gonna end up finding out is that I got a whole big list of tasks. And if I looked at optimizing each one of those individually, I may end up getting times out all over the board, right? What I wanna be looking now is obviously I'm not gonna go at hour, if I have an aircraft engine, I'm not gonna go look at part A after 2 flight hours and look at part B after 2.2 flight hours and look at part C after 2.25 hours. That makes sense. I want to group them in some way that makes sense. But again, we've got tools. If I've got all this information, I can start looking at clustering analysis, go back and start clustering those into groups of maintenance actions, and then rerun my analysis at the same time, look at what is the cost if I cluster all of those. So I'm going to take, that's the aircraft engine. I got FMEAs on each one of those that I was talking about. And as I go through that, I've done my RCM, I put my tasks. So I'm gonna go through a task packaging type of analyzer and start building little task packages that make sense. Because again, when you start going into the aircraft industry, you're gonna look at it, you got your 100 hour inspection, you got your 150 hour inspection perhaps, 500 hour inspection, but you're not gonna go do everything every so often. And once I've done all of that, I can go back and run my whole thing. Are my costs within what makes sense? Because obviously, if you look at individual optimums, those individual optimums in general would tend to be your cheapest option. But then you're also looking at practicality. The question is how much me adding practicality on getting this done has saved me, depending on what variables you look at. Once I'm done with that, I mean, the objective of this, what I would be doing is end up creating maintenance tasks for something. If it's a refinery, if it's an engine, then I could automatically fit them. And one of the things with synthesis, you've got the API, so I could go put them in SAP and basically set up your entire maintenance strategy at that point just by fitting everything in there of what I optimized and what something needs to be from a cost perspective. Put it into CMMS or whatever other system I want to put it in there. And again, I mean, all the stuff that even if you don't do maintenance, I could use a lot of that to look at things as costs. Back in the design, I've added cost to it. I could look at it as a designer, you know, what's the life cycle cost for my customer? And what do I tell my customer to do? So those could influence, again, design decisions as you go through it. Last but not least, as I go through that, I get down to my warranty phase. Other things I want to be doing there. As these things happen is I want to make sure that, again, I'm updating my information. You know, what's happening in the field, I need to know. I need to know as much of that as I can get. The more I get, the better. Okay, so if I've got things that are happening in the field, I need to start bringing them back into my knowledge base, into my system. I'd put those as failures into where I have them. They would go into that FMEA. Things that we tend not to consider when we actually do this thing up front. You start looking at things like storage, transportation. Yeah, I know some customers have made ATM machines. Yeah, nice heavy things, bolted to concrete, right? What vibration, what do I care? So, I mean, those are things that don't come to mind if you start thinking of ATM machines. Well, guess what? You got to take them from point A to point B on the back of a truck. Okay, what do you think happens during that transportation issue? Customer stuff. I mean, a lot of it goes to instructions, too. Sometimes customer may end up, because your instructions are not very good, sometimes you start getting failures from the customer. You need to know what those are. So make sure we're capturing whatever's in there. Again, customer usage, other things may come up. Do I understand what those are? So bottom line, I mean, at the end of the day, what I want to be doing is as that warranty data comes in, I want to also be updating that master list that I have. I don't stop it. Once I've released a product, I don't stop updating that master list of everything and all that data. I keep on updating that. And as I keep on up, why do I keep on doing that? Well, guess what? The second time I want to do it, I've got something that's ready for me to move over the second time. Okay, and I've got new failure modes I could have never considered. And there's a lot of them that are going to happen out there you've never seen. Okay, but again, if you've seen it on the field and you've got that in there, you need to know what that is. So same stuff. I mean, I'd be putting in a warranty system. Extragas could run a warranty system. There's a lot of options for that. And basically, as I get that new information, again, I keep on updating as I move through that and keep going forward. Now, as I get this data, it becomes kind of neat. I can start doing modeling. If I can extract data and build models, and this is where I would use your control charting. See, I haven't used it on the manufacturing side because I split it up, but there's nobody that said I couldn't go through there and actually start build control charts on returns or failures. Okay, I could go in there and start control charting what's happening in the field, or what incidents I'm seeing versus what I'm expecting to see, and then create an alarm system based from that perspective. And again, same concept, I'm just using it on the reliability side of things. Really, to me, it's about a process. The tools are there to enable a process, okay? Tools are capability. You gotta have the process. So if you're gonna ask me what's the hardest thing to do is actually make sure you've got the process in place. Yeah. Now, once you've got a process, then you need the capability. Software to me is a capability. And everything we built, one of the things that we've done totally different is that we developed the process and then we built the capability. So a lot of what you're gonna see in version 9 is everything was built to do this. So it's kind of once you came up with this, then you kind of build everything to do that. So whatever I showed you, you could do step by step, and it was designed to do so. So to me, the biggest thing I think I need to get across from people, and that's why I'm doing this, is that I think the process is something that's of great value to us as what we do as a community. And even though, again, pieces of that we might have used at different stages, it's really the value of using it from birth all the way to junking of a product that ends up basically giving you all the benefit. You get it faster, you get it better, and you get it cheaper. And again, that's the first time I say don't choose two, you could probably have all three.